Hello guys, good evening and welcome back to my Doctor Who marathon for the final story of Pactotron's Era. I've just been so excited to do this review for so many weeks, but now it's finally happened. Today we're going to be doing one of the most best and one of the most ultimate Doctor Who stories of all time, the 10-part epic thriller story that is The War Games. Now to be honest with you, I have decided to do this review not like any other review that I've previously done. This is going to be a way different review than I usually do. Apart from instead of doing all the reviews in one full go, I've actually decided to do this review in different parts because otherwise this camera can only film for about 3 hours. I'm not going to stand in front of a camera filming for 3 hours long talking about this DVD or the War Games. I'm not going to be doing that. And so what I've decided is to divide my review into sections. Firstly, this part, I'm going to be talking about the creative side and how the War Games came about to be Pactotron's finale story and how 1969 was the year of where Doctor Who was coming to the end of an era. And then we'll move on to the in-depth review on the War Games, and then we may move on to characters and their performances and those fight scenes as well, and then we'll do an overall conclusion on the War Games. And so that's how this review is going to work. And so if there's any point when I'm turning the camera off, it means that I'm going into another shot or I may edit it out, but there will be a lot of content talking about the brilliant War Games because you have to give every Doctor a brilliant send-off because Patrick Troughton's Doctor is just unbelievable. And to be honest with you, he's at the centre in this. So right now, we're going to be talking about how this came about and how 1969 was the year of where Doctor Who was coming to an end of an era. Because In that period of time, they were completely so struggling on trying to get scripts out and stories out for the audience to watch because it was just so a stressful time because there were so many scripts coming in, so many errors involved, and so the producer, Derek Sherwin, had to sort everything out. And so it becomes a really stressful time for Doctor Who. And so this, as Patrick Troughton has already announced that he was going to be leaving Doctor Who, it made sense to make him a brilliant, fantastic story, to give him a brilliant send-off. And so they were thinking about doing two other stories to make him, you know, to make those stories one of the best stories they can be. But unfortunately, Patrick Troughton didn't like the scripts. He absolutely hated the scripts, and so he forced the writers to rewrite them again or just completely scrap them because he didn't like the idea or, you know, their scripting, of course, or the story. He didn't like anything, and so he was so furious. To be honest with you, Patrick Troughton was a bit angry and he wanted one story to make him as the best Doctor possible and to give Doctor Who a brilliant send-off for its amazing years. And Patrick Troughton really wanted the show to continue for many years. And so he really wanted to give the entire audience a brilliant send-off for, you know, a magnificent Doctor. And so Derek Sherwin, the producer, came to Terrence Six, a really great script editor, decided to give Terrence Six the opportunity to write a 10-part story. And now, this is where Derek Sherwin was like talking to Terrence Six, right, Terrence, I need a 10-part story from you by the end of tomorrow or by next week. That was how much time they had to write the War Games. Only about next week or 24 hours, really. Nowadays, you can take your time on writing a 10-part story, maybe 2 months or a month. But that back then, they were really so much under pressure, under a week. And so Terrence Dix was paired up with Malcolm Hull because Terrence Dix wouldn't be able to do it on his own, and so he needed a great friend of him, Malcolm Hulk, which, as you know, does many fantastic stories in the John Perry era. But to be honest with you, I think both of them work such a great pair and they just make so much magic within their writing and just create such a fantastic, you know, idea on what this story could be about. And so they came back to Derek and they said to him, we want to do an idea called War Games or The War Games. And so they came up with this eccentric one-off series of The War Games, making it such a great finale story for Patrick Troughton, introducing new wars and having it such a great background behind it. And so it was literally how, you know, the aliens who were controlling the entire War Games wanted complete control of the entire galaxy. They wanted the strongest and, you know, best survivors of different wars to join their magnificent army to take over the entire galaxy. And so that was literally their idea on how they could introduce, but the War Games, they introduced so many concepts, and I think they put so many twists and turns within the writing. It made it so fascinating, so intriguing to watch. And you can literally see that the War Games is not a boredom story at all. I mean, most people, if you haven't seen the War Games, then you seriously must. From my point of view, from most people, they really love the War Games so much. But from some people, they really think that the War Games is 9 episodes of boredom, with then the last episode, the Time Lords come in and say, oh yeah, that's great. But no, that's not speakingly true. I think it's a generally well-paced story. It's actually a much snappier story than the 7-parters and 6-parters that Doctor Who has had back in the past. And so it feels like a really well-paced story. Possibly, the Daleks' Master Plan, I would have to say that is a bit too draggy for me. I mean, I couldn't watch that all in one go, but it did drag for me a bit, and so I wasn't hooked up to most of it in the Daleks' Master Plan. But this is well better than the Daleks' Master Plan, to be honest with you. I would have to say that this is just brilliant. If this story was lost, what would Doctor Who fans do? Seriously. But thank goodness we still have it, and it's still in good quality. I'm even amazed on how the quality even stands up till today. It seems fantastic. And to be honest with you, there were so many extraordinary twists and turns within this entire script. And it really made the entire story based around in different war zones. And so you can either go and move into a Roman zone, American Civil War zone, the Mexican Revolution, and the World War One. And so you got all of these wars introducing new characters, new settings, and a new plotline to go with the entire story. It really builds up to so much suspense, and it just drives the story so forward. It doesn't even make you so bored. And so that's the brilliant thing I like about the War Games. It's like the scripting's really well done. If you have a good script, a brilliant cast of characters, and the most importantly, a great director. The director was the most important person because the director, David Maloney, also directed The Mind Robber and also The Crotons. And so he really felt as a very encouraging director to get everybody going within the entire story, to make it more enjoyable and to make it the best final send-off for Patrick Troughton. And to be honest with you, he was just so fantastic. He wasn't one of those directors who usually says, oh no, I'm the director, you do what I say. But no, he really wanted to give every character or every actor or actress gave their input on what they could change or how they could, you know, fit for them. And so he was a really generally brilliant director, and so he really gave so much encouragement to all the actors to make it so thrilling and so enjoying. I just think David Malone just really made the story fantastic. I think this is one of his best creations for directing such a brilliant story. And to be honest with you, this War Games story actually has so many different twists and turns into it. It almost feels like they're like little history lessons. Whenever you go into a different war zone, you have different characters, a different setting point. There are little history lessons spiced throughout the story, and it's really great Doctor Who. The writing is just done to perfection. And Malcolm Hogg and Terry Sticks, my gosh, did a brilliant job on writing this entire script from just 1 week, and they had to basically put in all of the actors in it and what they were about to say, and also the script editing, they had to do all of that. And so it was really, really a brilliant story. Not unless the other two stories, which Patrick Troughton completely hated. Patrick Troughton really liked this one. And I also remember that Fraser Hines, who plays Jamie, and Wendy Padbury, who plays Zoe as well, they both really enjoyed the War Games, and they really liked David Maloney's directing. He was just so fantastic. And to be honest with you, many people nowadays would say that this is one of the best stories out there, and it is. No other story, well, I think many other stories can beat it, but to be honest, in the 1960s, with all the lost stories out there, if this one was lost, my gosh, we would be living in a state of hell in Doctor Who. To be honest with you, if this was lost, we would all panic. But thank goodness this stands up today, and the quality is just fantastic. And I think all of the characters in this, they have so much in-depth action and have so much energy. The writing, though, has so much energy. It makes the whole story going. It doesn't even make the whole story so draggy. It is just well directed. I'm actually trying to really enjoy this entire story. So Derek Sherwood was so impressed on how the story was get going with all the different war zones. And so everybody had their own inputs of what war zones they could think of. The Greek zone, the Japanese war between the Japan and Russia. And so all these different wars really kept the whole thing going and gave so much energy, a new set of characters, a new setting, a new set of plot lines. And I think the villains in it, there's an awful lot of conflict within talking about their ranks, and it is just generally how they really make the story so intriguing to watch. I think the writing is just spot on, just 10 out of 10 perfection. I mean, Terrence Dix is a really great writer. He's done many other stories, but I believe this was his first ever story he did for Doctor Who, writing it, well, co-writing it with Malcolm Hulk. Because this is the story that Patrick Troughton really wanted in the end. But this is just unbelievably epic. And so there's going to be all sorts of different in-depth content which I'm going to be telling you. I have my notes right here. To be honest with you, the writing is just absolutely spot on. And it was in that time, 1969, where Doctor Who was coming to an end of an era. It was Patrick Troughton's final story. And since everybody felt that Patrick Troughton was going, even Jamie or Fraser Hines, he decided, oh, since Pat's going because of family reasons, Fraser Hines really decided that his time's also up as well, because they really wanted to leave with Patrick Troughton, because if Patrick Troughton left the show and Jamie continued on for a few more episodes, it would become a bit boring, just Jamie on its own with a new Doctor. I mean, Patrick Troughton and Jamie, they're just so brilliant just working together. And also with Zoe as well. And so it really felt the end of an era for all actors in this entire story. Especially Patrick Troughton, Jamie and Zoe. And just really, I think Derek Sherwin also felt that his time as a producer was also up as well. And so this story really felt as the penultimate and ultimate final send-off story for Patrick Troughton, and to end off the greatest decade of the 1960s to a fantastic end. And gladly, John Pertwee managed to bring the whole story back to life in colour version, with John Pertwee encouraging the entire producers and the writers to continue to do more Doctor Who stories. This really was going to be the final end. This could have been the last ever Doctor Who story we could have ever had. But without John Pertwee's intervention with being the Doctor again, Doctor Who really came shot up in the viewing figures and really became such a brilliant sensational in the 1970s. And so it was really great for John Pertwee to take over the role as the Doctor, because Patrick Troughton really wanted this show to continue so much. And I really saw it in his eyes that he really wanted the show to continue. Please just do watch it, because I'm going to be telling you all the spoilers and everything in this entire story that makes it so enjoying to watch, full of energy, full of excitement. The magic that happened here within this story really brought Doctor Who fans back into the world of Doctor Who. Because although Doctor Who was a bit depressing back in those days, and really it was losing a bit of its viewing figures, but this really shot it up, and this really gave Doctor Who the brilliant send-off it absolutely deserved. And so I'm just absolutely happy that it exists still today. It's just fantastic. Anyway, guys, we're going to move on now into the in-depth review. Okay, now let's move on to the in-depth review. Now, before we start, I just want to say that it might be better if you should watch the War Games first, because I may be giving out a load of in-depth content and a lot of spoilers, because in these notes I have written down everything that happens within episode 1 of the War Games all the way to episode 10. So I've written down so much content about this review, because otherwise, if I didn't, then it would have been difficult for me to say what did I like about this entire story. And so I've written down all my notes down here, which I'll be basing around all of the content around this review. And so, really, I think you should basically watch the War Games first for your point of view, but it's your choice. You can either, watch the War Games first and then watch this review, or just watch it, if you've already watched it, then that's fine. You can always, continue watching it, but I advise you just watch the War Games first to get the feel and knowing of all the characters in the story. So yeah, the beginning of the War Games is really good. Trench warfare, no man's land, the World War One. It just creates such a dangerous and demolished atmosphere. The TARDIS lands in no man's land, and as you can expect from no man's land in World War One, such a dangerous and demolished time really in Earth's history. such a really fantastic setting, and I think the setting just really creates such a dangerous atmosphere for everyone. And even so, you know, people stuck down in trenches, it is such one of the worst wars in Earth's history. I would really like to watch this when it was on first transmission, because I just have this feeling that it would have been so ambiguous if I could just watch this entire story on the original transmission. It would just be so fantastic on not knowing of what happening in the story. And it's just being at those times just really creates that kind of awareness that you really enjoy it. I just really feel that perhaps watching it on the original transmission, but I know, if I had a TARDIS, I would do. But unfortunately, I have to say that this entire introduction to the war games just really creates such a dangerous atmosphere. And even at the beginning, we get introduced to the first supporting main characters in the story, and that is Lady Jennifer and Lieutenant Carstairs, which appear in episode 1 and it goes all the way to the end of episode and at the end of episode 9. So this is where really the main supporting characters come into play here, and most of their words that they talk about is morely, you know, locked in within their comprehension, because the warlords or the aliens behind us who have, you know, processed the humans in this entire story, they're kind of blocked most of the words and most of the objects that they can't really see, objects that are beyond their comprehension, they cannot see, or, you know, cannot say really, because they are just way beyond their comprehension. And so with most of them, they sometimes can't remember on how they got here in the first place or what year it is, and so they have a really bleak and very weird understanding of what year it is and how long they've been, you know, working for in this war zone. And so it's been quite difficult. So like, they all the soldiers and everybody's like, can't remember. In the court martial trial, introducing the first side villain, which there's going to be so many side villains in the war games, and this side villain, General Smile, was the first main villain in the first episode, and I thought his acting, played by Noel Coleman, was just fantastic. And the first thing that I noticed, he almost felt that he was on the winning side, and that is a great point to add to episode 1. Put the villain in the winning side, it makes him more power and makes him more powerful and feels that they're in control and they can deal with the situation very quickly and very fast, and they can do it really effectively. And so I noticed that General Smile didn't like the Doctor at all and completely changed the entire situation on whether they were guilty or they were, you know, charged with espionage and death. And so it was a really brilliant idea to put the villain in the winning side, because it makes him more powerful and much determined to get rid of the accusers and the citizens once and for all, because they believed that the citizens went out to the front line and got caught by the Germans and they wanted to steal some information, but that was not true. All of that, they made it up to make it such an unfair trial to prevent the Dr. Jamie and Zoe from, you know, protesting and defending against their alibis, really. And so they had no alibis at all, and so the court-martial had a very unfair trial. General Smile uses this technique to basically hypnotize, or, you know, put the soldiers in a hypnotic trance to make them feel that what they cannot see or what cannot say, really. And so there was one scene where General Smile was talking to some soldiers about the, you know, about the court-martial decisions on how on are these you know, citizens guilty or not. And so the two soldiers just beside him were saying, oh, I think they're just fine, I think we should let them go. Then General Smile puts his glasses on and then he looks at them. It is clear they are guilty. They are guilty. And then suddenly the two soldiers say, yeah, they're guilty. It completely changes the entire situation. It feels like he's in the winning state and feels so much in control, and he's such a powerful villain that you just cannot despise or even doubt for a moment, because otherwise he can change the entire situation just like that. And also his movement is very secretive. No matter where he goes, he always has this kind of charm that he really feels that he's in the winning state, and he moves so secretly when he's going into his office. And then suddenly when he goes into his cabinet and he pulls out a very secret and very telecommunications device, and that's put me to mind, hey, That's not from World War One. That's like an alien device or something. And so that really got me into the mood that, right, something's really wrong here. And the doctor really realised it when the court-martial was ended, that something's very wrong here, and like I'm not liking this. And so this really came into a field that everything is not going well, and everything doesn't seem quite right. And so the telecommunications office, the hypnotic trance, just doesn't make sense. And so how can the doctor, Jamie and Zoe be guilty? Because they've just landed in no man's land for just in the TARDIS, and they have no idea how they got in no man's land. And so they completely make up an alibi on how these strangers have infiltrated the base and tried to get over to the German lines. They created just a simple or made up story just to make the whole, to make generals might believe that these are humans, well, basically English spies that want to give the Germans more information about what they're planning against. So General Smythe completely sentenced the doctor to death, really, and he was planned to be shot on sight. So it just became such an incredible but very brilliant first episode, increasing the awareness of danger around, and also the doctor. I mean, the cliffhanger in episode one was so fantastic. The doctor being shot on sight, it was just so a really great cliffhanger. And with this entire story, you really just want to keep the whole thing going. Episode one just really sets the bar really high. A war zone, you know, World War One's setting, really, with all the bombs and trench warfare. It just creates such a dangerous atmosphere. And then you've got the unfair trial, which may seem a bit unfair for the doctor, Jamie and Zoe, to defend themselves. And then General Smythe sentenced to death. And so that's the introduction to the War Games for episode one. And I think that's a really great start for the War Games, creating awareness and also the danger around them, the doctor, Jamie and Zoe. And so it's a really great first starting episode. And for most of the supporting characters, we get introduced to Carstairs and Lady Jennifer. And so it was really great. And also all of the other soldiers were really good as well. And so it's a really great first episode, really. And so episode two now. Now for episode two, straight away, we are introduced to somebody who is not from World War One. Somebody who is from 1745 in the English Civil War zone. And to be honest with you, it doesn't really make sense. Now, how did this redcoat even get into World War One? It just creates so many questions. Like, how did this person end up in World War One? It just created so many questions throughout the entire episode. Different people and different objects are messed up in different time zones, which really created that people like General Smythe, who still have a free mind, and like, you know, all of the processed humans within the episode, they still have a free mind, they can still think properly, but it's just everything that's going around them, what's actually happening in the entire episode, is way beyond their comprehension, and they just can't understand what's going on. And so they have no clue that they believe that something is very, very wrong here, but they just can't think, and just they can't understand what's actually going on here. And so it's really up to the Doctor, Jamie and Zoe, just to help them out, Carstairs and Lady Jennifer, for them to just understand what's going on in this entire, you know, situation. And so really, I think the Doctor does help in some case or way with Lady Jennifer and Carstairs understanding about the entire situation, that different people and different objects are messed up in different time zones. And with the mist, I mean, the mist was really confusing me. And so, like, how did this redcoat even get into the World War One, you know, zone or stuff like that? And how Lady Jennifer Carstairs and the redcoat kept explaining about this sort of mist. And so this mist was really intriguing me. And, like, what was it, you know, about? And so this force field is almost like a mist or fog, almost like a gateway to different more time zones. Almost like a force field that really brings people or processed humans, if they go into it, something happens to their minds and they can't really think straight. But unprocessed humans, such as the Doctor, Jamie and Zoe, who can go through the mist so easily, they can't be affected. But with processed humans, they are easily affected by it because it's confusing their comprehension and they can't think straight. And so with that put in place, this is why they have characters like General Smite putting in the different war zones to prevent these processed humans from going into the mist and, you know, causing them to go a bit mental and become part of a resistance group. With this resistance group is where these people are, you know, beyond unprocessed and they can fight against the processed effects. And so this is where Carstairs and Lady Jennifer become part of a resistance group. And this is, and just really, it's such a really great episode. Especially with the Doctor, you know, becoming such a brutal and very arrogant, a very aggressive character when it comes to when he's pretending to become somebody from the War Office and insults the soldier on being such an "how dare you" shouts at the top of his voice, just pretending to be somebody from the War Office, gaining more power and just manipulating that soldier so well. He just really became so controlled in the entire situation, and he automatically knew what these prisoners were going to about, and he was really intact just to save Jamie's life, really, to prevent these, you know, to prevent the Highlander from getting shot on sight. And so really, unfortunately, the Red Coat does get shot, but it was a really interesting thing for the Red Coat to be introduced into the story because it created a lot of questions around the entire episode, which in later episodes, the answers will be found and hopefully answered most of those questions. So really, I really enjoy episode 2. It really creates much more of the danger. And of course, the cliffhanger. It's just so well done. And it's where Carstairs, Lady Jennifer, the Doctor, Jamie and Zoe go into the mist. And I know Lady Jennifer and Carstairs, they go into the mist and they get affected by the mist. Which then the Doctor goes into, you know, drives the car into the other time zone. And they sort of listen to, like, no bombs or no guns at all. And so they're completely into a different time zone. But then looking at, I mean, the music is just fantastic. I think I just love the music of the War Games. I think I just really want a soundtrack. But just really, when they went up a hill and just felt so peaceful and so relaxing. And then Zoe and the Doctor and Jamie saw something in the valley. And it was actually Romans. Romans actually charging towards them. And they became so panicky. And then this is where the cliffhanger really came into play. And just became such a really panicky but very great moment, really. And so Romans. This is where Carstairs and Lady Jennifer experience people from a different time zone. And this is really where the whole story really kicks into play. And with the war zones, I think really having different war zones after every single episode really intrigues the entire episode, and it just really makes the whole story carry on further on. It's a never-ending story, and so this is why they introduce so many wars to keep the whole thing going. And so it's a really great episode. Especially with the processed humans, because the processed humans, they can't really think straight. Everything is beyond their comprehension, because the warlords, the organization, the organizers who has organized this entire war games, has actually kidnapped these humans out of their own time and put them into a context which is sort of like Earth, but it's almost like looked like Earth, but they are actually fighting the same wars in which they were taken from, to see if the warlords can identify which survivors are actually the best to create some kind of stronghold army. And so this is where how they get into their advanced technology and kidnapping. It's such a very vile, you know, process, and how kidnapping people from their own times and putting them into a context which seems like Earth and still fighting the wars in which they were taken from just seems like a very vile and inhuman thing to do, really. And so, yeah, it's a really interesting episode. I really like episode 2. And again, increases the danger, and it really puts many questions on hold. But then most of the answers are given in most of the later episodes. The Doctor is just such a really aggressive and brutal, you know, character when he's talking to one of the guys in the military prisons. And so we get to see Patatron's very seriousness, his worriedness, but also he gets very cautious and has a very clowning around character. He's such a versatile actor, and he's just really become such a real, he just gets into the mood straight away, becoming so serious and becoming so aware of the entire situation. He just really gets everything on the move and really creates such a pacing and great atmosphere. And even so, with all these history lessons come about, it really gives the whole story some really in-depth content in history and wars. So to be honest with you, the war zones just really helped the whole thing going. And I think episode 2 was really where the process humans were trying to think of like what's going on here and how they kind of think straight. And if you put General Smite out of the picture, you can sort of see that things sort of have, you know, a negative effect on what's going on. People escape, people go through into the mist. And so with General Smite put out of the picture, things really do seem to change. And so this is where the episode really goes into another direction, into another time zone, and really intrigues the entire audience just to keep watching the entire story. Part 3, this is where the entire plot really starts to get going. The Doctor, Jamie, Zoe, cast as Lady Jennifer, they go back into the mist, away from the Romans, since the cliffhanger in episode 2 was basically the chariots charging towards them. But now, since now they have, they go back into the mist, the Romans can't even follow them because they're processed humans, and they can't really follow them into the mist, which the mist creates. It's just a force field which can be put into place to put as a great advantage for the Doctor, Zoe, Jamie, Carstairs, Lady Jennifer to be situated in, because none of the processed humans can ever get into it. So it feels like a really safe place for them to hide, or because none of the processed humans can ever go in and flush them out, really. And so General Smile in this episode was really Morley to his disappearance, really. This is where he really goes out of the story for much of the later episodes, and then appears yet again back in episode 7. So he does appear. I mean, he was only here for episode 1 and 2, really, just to deal with the Doctor very quickly and very effectively. He has just some kind of quite serious and quite arrogance about him, which makes him, he can deal with people very quickly, and he can really change the entire situation just like that with this hypnotizing technique of using his glasses. And so that he was really just introduced for episodes 1 and 2, really. And then for this episode, we really get to see the kind of comparison of villains, because as the Doctor, Jamie, Zoe, Carstairs, and Lady Jennifer go back to the chateau in 1917, in the World War One zone, they really want to go back to the chateau and try and find a map, because the Doctor's very intrigued about these entire war zones, and he has some kind of conspiracy that if they find a map, which may lead to a map containing all war zones on this kind of place, really. And so this entire place is divided up into time zones, and so they found a map containing all war zones, like American Civil War Zone, American Revolution, the English Civil War Zone. So there's loads of different wars, and so there was a little blank space in the middle, which that seems like the in kind of aim in order for them to get to, because that's the inside the central control point where the entire war game is operating from. And so we actually get to see the first ever appearance of the command center with the all of the advanced technology and all the people controlling all of the war zones from one situated location. And then we get the first appearance of the war chief, which, as you know, is a very great character, and his character really gets developed in much later episodes. But here, this is where we get to see his kind of power and his authority and rank. He sometimes thinks to himself, like, time travelers, I wonder. I actually wonder if he actually knows the Doctor, or is he a friend of the Doctor, or does he know him? And so this is where the War Chief becomes a very interesting character, because you really want to know that, is he a friend of the Doctor, or are they both from the same race? And so that really creates a lot of questions for the War Chief, because as the Doctor go all to into the different time zone and try to find the central control zone, they get stopped at the German front lines, which prevents them from going into other time zones. But with the German front lines, a German soldier kind of interrogates the Doctor and really tells, and then the Doctor, Joe, Jamie and Zoe, they tell the truth of them being time travellers from the distant future and the past as well. And so this German soldier doesn't really believe them, but then when the Doctor demonstrates a sonic screwdriver, he really believes it, and therefore the process, you know, his processed mind can be unprocessed, and he can really believe that these people are not actually spies, they're actually time travellers. But then this is where the interesting part really comes into play, and I really like this really great character that comes into play just after, when he just demonstrated the sonic screwdriver bits. And it's the German leader, Von Wei, played by David Garfield. And now I have to say that his villain is so manipulative and so sinister. I think to compare General Smile with Von Wei, I would have to say Von Wei is the better villain, because of his sinister factors. He can deal with people very quickly, and he's not the person to be provoked. He is the one person who provokes others. And so he really seems like a general threat, really. And so I really like his sign of spark, and when he kind of deals with a certain situation, like one of his soldiers really telling them that there are time travelers, and when he puts the monocle on, this is where he really gets so sinister. It's almost like the same hypnotizing technique as General Smite uses with his glasses, but Von Wei does it with his monocle, and it's so creepy and so sinister, and he can change the entire situation just like that. And really, basically, from 1 minute ago, the German soldier was thinking, oh yeah, they're time travelers, not really harmful. But then when Von Wei talks to him and hypnotizes him, then he suddenly comes back into the room and tells them that you are Germans, that you are English spies, really. And so this is how Von Wei is so powerful in his rank, and he becomes such a very sinister character. I just really prefer Von Wei because even so, when in the central control zone, when the prisoners have escaped, when Von Wei is reported to the central control zone, General Smile really freaks out, really. And he gets so panicky about how they could have the prisoners escaping, really. But with Von Wei, he feels so calm, and he doesn't really seem so that panicked. And so that's the reason why I love Von Wei the most. He's more of this sinister character who can really deal with things very quickly, and he is so calm. Even when he has a gun to his head, he can really deal with things very calm, and he's so cool as a cucumber. Whereas with General Smite, he's very panicky, and he sometimes gets a bit nervous when things are not going according to plan. And so this is why General Smite only appears for only a 3 episodes and then goes away for episode 7. Well, comes back in episode 7, but Von Wei really appears all throughout until where he unfortunately gets shot, spoiler alert. But then, I think Von Wei is just a brilliant, manipulative and sinister character. I think he has this sort of sinister edge which makes him so of a powerful villain, a powerful threat towards others. And he's the person who can provoke others, but he's the one who cannot be provoked because he's so calm. And so really, whenever you're trying to point a gun at him, you're the one actually feeling scared, not him. And so that's the reason how sinister he can be. Then the doctor, Jamie and Zoe, Carr says, a lady Jennifer, they escape from the German front lines and they go into another time zone, which then they make way into the American Civil War zone, which I have to say that the fighting scenes are just absolutely fantastic. The direction, just absolutely fantastic. And I really just have to say that there's a lot of fights in the American Civil War zone. And really, this is where Carstairs really gets separated from the Dr. Jamie, Zoe, and Lady Jennifer, because they get captured by the American soldiers and then get brought back for reprocessing. And then when the war chief said reprocessing, that sort of triggered a little question mark in my head, like, what did the word reprocessing mean? Like, are these people actually human or inhuman? So I didn't really understand that point. But then when the whole entire thing made sense in episode 4, I really understand how all of these people are now processed and unprocessed. But continuing with the American Civil War zone, it's a really fantastic war zone, a lot of great fight scenes. I think Carstairs is just fantastic, and I would have to say the main supporting characters, Lady Jennifer and Carstairs, are just so brilliant in this story. I would have to say my favourite is Carstairs because he's more of a likeable character. I mean, you can't really hate him. He's just so loyal and so faithful to the Doctor. He can get the Doctor out of any situation, really. So he's a really great supporting character. Lady Jennifer sometimes goes a bit... She's overshadowed in many scenes, really, because there's always loads of other characters coming into play, so she gets very overshadowed. But okay, again, she's a really great supporting character. And then the cliffhanger, where there's a time capsule machine that kind of appears in the barn. And this actually appears in actually episode 2, when General Smite actually goes for an important meeting. There's a time capsule machine, and he actually goes into it and it dematerializes. So it's almost like a representation of the TARDIS. But is the TARDIS long-lasting, or does these machines, you know, expire really, really quickly? And then suddenly the Doctor investigates and goes in, and then Zoe follows him, and then Jamie and Lady Jennifer, they get separated from the Doctor and Zoe, and then because the time capsule actually dematerializes, and Jamie is actually left on his own without the Doctor or Zoe, really. And so he's really just stuck in his own, really, for the last cliffhanger of episode 3. And so it's almost like, how's Jamie going to survive on his own with just Lady Jennifer? And what's the Doctor and Zoe in for in episode 4 when they're going into the time capsule? Now for episode 4. Okay, now for part 4. Now, part 4, this is where of course, Jamie and Lady Jennifer, they're stranded, they're without the Doctor and Zoe, because the Doctor and Zoe have made their way into a time capsule and they've been dematerialized somewhere, and they're in this big room, just like the same with the TARDIS, yes, but then they find huge amounts of soldiers different from different time zones. They found Roman soldiers, they found World War One soldiers, American soldiers, and all these different soldiers. They're under like some kind of hypnotic trance, which makes them feel like they're like not moving at all. They don't move at all, they're not even blinking. They're just there, just standing there in front until they give like a sort of a signal to make to take them to their actual time zones, prepare them for war, really. And so it was a good way of understanding that, like, these people, these aren't real people, they are process people, people that have been taken out from their own time. And really, this is where the entire plot starts to thicken up on how these people got here and how they were taken from. And so they also, the Doctor and Zoe, they made their way down to the central control zone by using the time capsule to make sure that it was landing in the central control zone. They managed to arrive there without being noticed, and they attend a lecture, which makes them think that they're students trying to learn about these, you know, processing devices. And then the scientist was talking, doing a lecture about how to reprocess and how these people are under some kind of hypnotic trance. And it's all about how this place isn't Earth. For most of the time, the human specimens that they have been using have been basically taken out of their own time and put them into a context which seems to be the same like Earth. But instead, they're still, it is vital for them to continue to believe that they're still living their normal life on Earth and fighting the wars in which they were taken from. And so the Doctor and Zoe realise that this isn't Earth at all. It's a facsimile like Earth, but just way different in a similar context to Earth. But just, it makes the humans think that it's like Earth, but fighting the wars in which they were taken from, but it's there so that the warlords can actually decide on whether which ones, which soldiers or which people are the true survivors and who have the courageous skills and abilities to become true survivors. Most of the specimens from the processed soldiers have developed some kind of way of resisting, and particularly involve a great deal of strong character and individuality, so therefore they are able to penetrate the time zone barriers and join resistant groups with other members who have not been processed or who have been resisting a lot, and so they've been joining up together, forming resistant groups, and so therefore these resistant groups will be able to take over the War Chief's plan. So this is where they're trying to get rid of all of the resistant people and trying to convert them back to become processed. But the scientist, I really like the scientist's, you know, personality, and he's really committed to do what he's told by the War Chief, and he's been, you know, he's a very strange scientist, but I really still like his voice and his character, or the actor who plays the scientist, a very great actor. I think the War Chief was a bit surprised when he saw the Doctor face to face, and like, did they two know each other? And like, it was such a really intense moment. With Lady Jennifer and Jamie, I would have to say that the course have been a bit of a loop story, or a loop episode, which I mean is that for like the start of the episode, they get captured and by American soldiers and they get tied up, and then suddenly they're trying to escape by, you know, trying to resist, and then suddenly they do escape. And then Jamie does have a bit of fun with riding a few horses, saving Lady Jennifer, and the music is just fantastic. And having Jamie having a load of fun with all the stunts around and having a bit of a run around, and suddenly they get all recaptured again. And then that's basically like wasting about 10 minutes of the episode, really, of being captured, trying to escape, and then suddenly be recaptured. So that really is basically wasting about 10 minutes. But during those 10 minutes of trying to escape and then being recaptured, Jamie did have a lot of fun with riding on the horse, fighting all the soldiers away, and it was just a really, you know, fantastic moment. I mean, a great highlight for Jamie, because this is the Jamie we know all love and know and love, and he just really wanted to have so much adventure with this episode, and he really just had so much fun doing so many stunts, and it was just a really great highlight for Jamie. The Black American soldier who was part of the American Civil War, but he was one person who resisted the Von Wade's hypnotizing mind controlling technique. And so he is also known as a resistant member who is part of the people who actually know the who are the real enemies behind all of this and what they're actually doing here. And so he was actually a resistant member who was trying to gather up more resistant members from different time zones and form one big group army to take over the real enemies behind this whole scheme and this whole operation. So that was a really explaining of how all these resistant members are associated to different time zones, because not all of the processes have been successful throughout all of the time zones. So there are resistant members in different time zones, but this person was thinking about of how he could join up with these resistant members and join and overcome the enemies. So yeah, it's a really great episode, and although many people would say that this episode really takes a bit of a drag and it may be a bit of padding, which kind of stops it from going into, you know, a bit further in a great intensive direction, really. There's not really a lot going on in this episode, but many people really say that this is a bit of a drag. But I would have to say that the Dalek's Master Plan, although, yes, a classic story, but yes, a lot of drag. Really, the Dalek's Master Plan has more drag, but with the War Games, there's nothing there to be dragged about. Although episode 4 creates just a little bit of drag with all of the recapturing and trying to escape and then so they get recaptured again. So that does create a little bit of drag, but it's a 10-part episode. They have to include so much to do and they have to, you know, include so much action to keep the whole thing going. And so, yeah, I don't think there's a lot of padding in the War Games, but I think the Dark Master Plan is an example of how so much padding is situated in that classic story. The Dark Master Plan is 12 episodes long, and there is so much drag in this. But with the War Games, there's no drag at all, well, except for in episode 4. So I would have to say episode 4 is more the weakest, in my opinion. And yes, the cliffhanger again was Carstairs and then finds Zoe and tries to shoot her, really. So that's really the cliffhanger for episode 4, which I know that Zoe's going to get out of it or someone's going to stop Carstairs from shooting her, which I honestly knew it was going to be that kind of a cliffhanger. But yeah, Carstairs, the scientist has like developed this kind of way of trying to deprose somebody of all of their mental minds and then reprocess them to become a processed human as every other soldier in this War Games. So really, this episode was really almost like was the loop story from being captured, then trying to escape, and then suddenly again being recaptured, wasting about 10 minutes, but then also learning about the entire plot. And so the plot thickens in this episode on what's the concept of these War Games and why are these people being kidnapped and being in an enslaved army for the War Chief's, you know, evil plan. And so, yeah, it's a really, you know, a really underrated episode. Many people would have to say that, you know, episode 4 is the weakest. I think the action when Jamie's doing the fighter scene is just really good. And also the plot thickens when the scientist is explaining of how all of these people have been continuing to believe that they're living their normal life on the planet Earth and fighting the wars in which they were taken from. So it does seem similar, and it also does create a lot of answers for many of why of these people on Earth, or is it Earth? And so it does create a lot of answers. And so, you know, we might as well continue with episode 5 now. Right, now for part 5. Part 5. This is where we get introduced to another good villain into the entire story. I think the direction and the precise moment of introducing each villain in each episode is absolutely spot on. If you introduce villains at the very, very start of the story, you're not going to get that incredible suspense as you would do if you watched the War Games properly. Each villain is introduced in a certain episode, which creates a lot of character development for in every single episode. Now, the Security Chief, this is the new villain that gets introduced to this episode. Now, I would have to say that the Security Chief does get a lot of animosity and does have a little rant with the War Chief about his incompetence and how the Security Chief is such an incompetent person, and he gets really angry with the War Chief that they don't like each other, they hate each other, and there's always an awful lot of conflict within their own ranks. And so the Security Chief feels so threatening when he's talking to the War Chief, but the War Chief completely doesn't like the Security Chief as well, because straight away the Security Chief notices that the War Chief is such a traitor towards his own people, making himself so self-centered about himself, and he's so power hungry that he actually wants, you know, he's so destined for power power, and he only wants complete control of this entire operation just to rule the galaxy. And that's what the security chief notices straight away. In the beginning, Zoe does get away, but then she is sent to the security chief to be interrogated. And when Zoe is interrogated, you can almost see that Zoe is under some kind of mental, you know, pain. When the security chief is interrogating her, she is forcing herself to tell herself the truth of how she came here in the first place. So it's almost like a mental interrogation, really. And so no matter how much she's trying to resist it, it's causing her mind to shatter, really, causing her so much pain. And so it's a great way of interrogating her to tell the truth. And so this is where the security chief has so much animosity, and he really just have so much character development with the war chief as well. They don't like each other, and just they really just have so much rant, and have a big rant and an argument between them, discussing where the war chief's expectations lie and where does his loyalty lie. Now, since he's a traitor of his own people, the war chief, where does his expectations lie and his loyalty? Does he actually serve and actually like the security chief? Or does he want possession and power for himself and become supreme ruler of the entire galaxy? That what separates them both. They just don't like each other, but the security chief automatically knows straight away that he's up to something, and the security chief is destined to find out what the war chief is planning out. He's so self-centered, and the war chief just also doesn't like the security chief because he believes that he is just so incompetent with his job and he can't do his job properly. And that what the warlord doesn't like at all, and he gets introduced into episode 7, and he doesn't like when things aren't going according to plan, when they both are arguing about the incompetence and how the security chief wants destined proof and evidence to accuse the war chief and get fired by the warlord. I would have to say that there is one little scripting error, which I'm not 200% sure if it was accidental or if it was there on purpose. It was the scene where the doctor was shouting, "Run, Zoe, run!" And then the doctor goes and kind of wanders into the scientist's laboratory and trying to deprocess Carstairs. And so it was probably wondering, like, what are you doing here? It's like, there's an alarm for you. Like, no, not me, the girl, but why did you run? And so, like, no, I was trying to catch her, of course. I mean, that really doesn't make any sense. Like, why did the doctor say, "Run, Zoe, run," when the doctor was trying to catch her? It doesn't make any sense. I'm not sure if that was on purpose or an accident, really. I'm not too sure. But I believe it was just there for a reason, and I'm not 100% sure what that reason is. And so it was a really strange moment of how the scientist was very tricked so easily, but that made the doctor and Carstairs get away quite easily and trying to rescue Zoe from the interrogation from the security chief. And from that moment, they decided to form one big resistance group, because what the scientists and the security chief and the war chief don't like is that the resistance groups are being built up bigger and bigger and bigger. And so they really want to eliminate the resistance groups once and for all. And so with that being said, they just really want to figure out some way on trying to reduce the amount of resistant members within each time zones. And this is why the security chief and the war chief are so incompetent within their own jobs. They can't do their jobs properly and can't get rid of them all. And so this is why the doctor tries to plan out a big resistance group to take over the entire control center. And so it's a really great episode, and I believe that Russell, the American captain or the leader, gets introduced into the episode right away when there's a fight scene going on between two American soldiers. And this is, I think, the direction on the fighting is so fantastic. I think David Maloney is just really fantastic. But again, back to Russell. But Russell, I would have to say, out of Carstairs and Russell, I would have to say Carstairs is more developed. But although Russell is introduced in episode 5, I would have to say that he has less faith in the doctor than Carstairs does. Carstairs is more reliable, and you can see he's very loyal to the doctor. But with Russell, you can almost see that kind of diversity that he has, and he just doesn't trust the doctor fully. And so I can almost see that Russell is a really great, bold character, shares the same characteristics with Carstairs, but really, I believe that Carstairs is well better character developed than Russell. But although Von Wei does get captured in this episode, because He's trying to send a distress signal to the central control zone, but then he gets captured by Jamie and gets caught by sending a distress signal, which then these guards are actually going down to the American Civil War zone to see if there's any trouble around. But they do get ambushed by the resistance group and take over the guards. And so they have a time machine, which is the same machine that the Doctor and Zoe traveled in to get to the central control zone. And so Russell and Jamie go inside the machine and actually travel to the central control zone to find the Doctor and see if they can destroy or find the Doctor in order to destroy the, you know, the enemies behind the entire operation, the security chief and the war chief. But then this war chief automatically ordered the guards to go down to the landing bay and post as an ambush towards the resistance members coming to the central control zone. And so from that point on, there was a little cliffhanger at the end, which actually shows that Jamie was actually being killed in the end. Actually just showed that Jamie was actually in danger, actually being ambushed by the guard. And this is where the entire episode really goes into a break, really, because the War Games is 10 episodes long, but also in the DVD, you get different discs. So you got like episode 1 to episode 5, and then the next disc, you've got episode 6 to episode 10. So you can really just take a break in between each disc. And so this is where this is where you can almost like take a break with this entire story. But yeah, I think episode 5 really develops the character development between the security chief and the war chief, and how they both don't like each other, and how they're so incompetent within their own jobs, they're within their own ranks. And so yeah, episode 5 is really good, and also creates such more of the fight scenes as well with Dave Maloney's great direction. And then Zoe and the Doctor and Carstairs trying to escape, trying to form one big resistance group. And so yeah, it's a really great episode, but most importantly, it introduces the security chief and the war chief with their character development and their argument and their dislike between each other. And so we definitely know what the war chief is up to, and that he's a traitor, and he's probably thinking that I want power, I'm so self-centered, and he wants power for himself. Whereas the security chief really notices straight away that he doesn't like, and he knows that the war chief is up to something. He destines to find out what. Okay, now we're at the halfway line, episode 6. Now, episode 6, things really start to get heated up, not for the good guys in this episode, but mainly for the bad guys in this episode, with the security chief and also the war chief completely still moaning and ranting on about their arguing and their dislike between each other. And so really, this episode really has more focusing around the argument and the dislike of the war chief and the security chief, really. So that really has a big effect, and it starts to get very heated up between their relationship and their hating each other, really. And so they don't really get along that well, as explained in the episode 5. They just really don't like each other. I think when it came to the cliffhanger, even for episode 6, and the reason why I'm talking about the cliffhanger right now is just to say that when the Doctor and Carstairs go into the machine and try to dematerialize away from the central control zone with Jamie, they actually get stopped by the war chief and the security chief in the machine, and they said, like, surrender now and your lives will be spared. And so this really had an effect on the power and the authority of both of them had. The security chief completely decided, we'll wait for them to come out. And so the war chief was like, no, we'll force them out. And so the war chief activated some dimensional control and completely caved in the room onto the Doctor, Carstairs and Jamie, forcing them to come out. So with that being said, I would have to say that the war chief has much more power and authority over the security chief. When the chief scientist was actually examining the brain patterns of the resistance members, he actually found Jamie as a great specimen. And then the war chief was like, why do you want to take this to the security chief? I just found that his brain pattern is quite different. How? And I was like, he's not been processed before. Really? How interesting. So that really just points to how Jamie is such a really great specimen, because he has not been processed before, which actually gives the security chief and the war chief something to work on. So something that could happen within their plan. But again, morally, they were focusing about their ranting and arguing with each other. And this is why the warlord in episode 7 really cuts them out, because with them incompetence of them arguing about their traits and their disloyalty to each other, they are ruining the warlord's plan, and they're not even focusing around of getting rid of and eliminating the resistance groups.
And so that's what they should be focusing on right now. They should really be focusing around solving and trying to get rid of the resistant groups. But no, they're completely ranting on each other. And even so, the war chief was like so threatening to the security chief that if you post any sort of neg of proof towards me that can accuse me of me being guilty, I shall crush you. The security chief, that he actually wants the war chief to find some actual evidence to blame or frame the war chief get having complete control of the entire war games operation and wants destined power to rule the entire galaxy. That's what he wants to find some proof to frame the war chief. Also, Von Wei in this episode, he does get shot in the end by Private Moore. He was actually played by David Troughton, Patrick Troughton's son. And it was a really great moment for Patrick Troughton's son, David Troughton, to have a little scene with him for his final story in Doctor Who. A great father and son moment. Really fantastic. But the most important thing I really liked about the scene with where Private Moore was actually guarding Von Wei. As you know, Von Wei, serious as sinister as ever, and very serious, very manipulative towards anybody who's trying to provoke him. But he's the one who cannot be provoked. And so he stays so calm, so Private Moore is just completely so scared of Von Wei with his sinister, intimidating look. He actually gives Private Moore the actual shivers. Von Wei is actually one of the most sinister and most manipulative characters in the entire war games. And this has such an effect on Private Moore's ability to keep guard on Von Wei, because he can strike at any moment, and he's so calm, so cool. Just really love this character. And I mean, I'm disagreeing about why Von Wei should have died first. I mean, I should have thought that General Smile would have died first, not Von Wei, because Von Wei is more sinister and he has more factors to his character. Whereas with General Smile, if you actually introduce General Smile back into the story, he wouldn't get even recognised, because you can have all of these other villains. You've got the security chief, you've got the war chief, and you've got the warlord introduced to episode 7. So General Smart actually gets very, very overshadowed and just doesn't really get recognised. And so there's really no point of him being in the story anymore, because he has no power over, you know, what's actually happening in the whole operation anymore. I mean, it was good for episodes 1 and 2 and episode 3, but when it goes into episode 7, he gets very overshadowed by all of the other villains. So I would have preferred him dying first and then Von Wei, because with now Von Wei's death, it actually puts on some pressure on the war chief and the security chief to find the resistant members and actually destroy them once and for all. And so this is where the entire story really gets kicked into overdrive. And now the warlord is starting to arrive. It's actually now starting to become quite a difficult situation for the war chief and the security chief. But hopefully in episode 7, the warlord will actually sort their bickering out once and for all. And that's just how the warlord is, just so powerful. So really, it's a really great, interesting episode. And it just really shows the relationship between the war chief and just the security chief just don't liking each other. But then as I said again, the war chief, is he working alongside the doctor since they are both from the same race, as they both can both travel through space and time? So really, it's just a really interesting episode. And unfortunately, Von Wei does get killed off in the end. But I think the cliffhanger, again, is just really fantastic. With the dimensional controls and even forcing the prisoners coming out of the machine. And to be honest with you, I think the war chief has destined more power and more authority than the security chief. So I think you can see the hierarchy in power and authority. So you can actually see that the warlord is top in power and authority. Then it goes down into the war chief, which he has like second in command and second authority. And then you've got the security chief, which unfortunately has the lower, you know, authority and less power really against the war chief. So there's a little obligations, there's loads of jealousy between their own ranks of authority. And so it's really fascinating just to watch episode 6. And then moving on to episode 7, this is where things really get heating up. And so let's move on to episode 7. Okay, now for episode 7. Now episode 7, this is where we get all of the villains introduced now. We had the war chief introduced to episode 3. The security chief introduced in episode 5, and now we finally get the warlord introduced in episode 7, which I have to say that the warlord is my favourite character in the entire war games, played by the brilliant Philip Maddock, really fantastic actor. He's a world-class actor, and he automatically knows what he's going to say in any situation when it comes to bickering about the war chief and the security chief with all their interrogations, they're contradicting each other and really becoming so disloyal to each other. And really, the warlord is just here just to stop them bickering with each other and really wants to get the job done really fast, because with them two bickering about each other and how they're contradicting each other with their traits and betrayals, the warlord cannot deal with incompetence. He seems as a real threat towards the security chief and the war chief as well. And even so, when the security chief and the war chief are talking to the war chief, to the warlord, they sometimes stutter within their lines because they feel that the warlord is just so intimidating, and they completely generally feel so scared of him because they feel like they haven't done the job to his satisfaction. And really, the warlord is completely so furious with both of them with their incompetence of not doing the job properly. And so the warlord, I have to say, is just a brilliant, fantastic character, and his character just developed so much more within all of the other episodes. And so this is why the warlord is here, to stop them bickering with each other. So that he sees such as a big authority figure, and he's just been so furious with the war chief and the security chief for how incompetent they've been throughout the entire time. He's just been so furious with both of them, and he's absolutely had enough with both and threatens them both. If this continues anymore, he will get rid of them both personally. The security chief, the war chief, and the warlord are all brilliant, fantastic actors, and I think their performances are just so fantastic. The time capsule actually landed in another time zone, which was actually, in fact, the Roman zone, which they had to go back into the mist and go back to 1917, back to the chateau, where they actually found General Smythe was actually waiting for them there. And so they had this interrogation of the general being so malicious as well. And again, really, I thought that the threat was not that, you know, threatening at all, because I really thought that with all the three villains situated in within the entire story, I didn't really think that General Smythe actually played a big deal in showing a big of a threat towards the Doctor or in the entire story. I think he was pretty good for episodes 1, 2 and 3. But with episode 7, I thought his character was a bit sidetracked by all of the other villains, the security chief, the war chief and the warlord. So I would think that his character sometimes is really overshadowed and a bit wasted, I would have to say, in my honest opinions. He just really doesn't seem over like a big of a threat towards the Doctor. And then suddenly his entire chateau gets invaded by the resistance group, and then suddenly he gets killed off in the end. Now here's my problem. I would have had General Smythe died first than Von Wei, because I think Von Wei is such a great Cybern and he's much better than General Smythe. I think General Smythe has loads of unfactors about him. I mean, his factors are good, but I think Von Wei has more factors. He's more sinister and he's more manipulative, whereas with General Smythe, sometimes when things go wrong, he sometimes freaks out, whereas with General Smythe or with Von Wei, he's sometimes very calm and very cool about the situation. So I think Von Wei is such a better side villain. And then the Doctor tries to put up a force field all around the chateau, because the warlord tried to plan out some conventional force of attacking of putting loads of different war people attacking the chateau, the German front lines coming towards the English chateau, and they were trying to see if they could, you know, flush out the resistance group. But the Doctor managed to activate some kind of control, and it created some sort of mist around the entire chateau, which that prevented all of the processed humans from going into the chateau. Since now the resistance groups, they have a really great situated headquarters, which they can plan their organize their plan in order to take over the entire war games. I would have to say that the cliffhanger at the end is sometimes a bit, I would say it's okay. I wouldn't say it's much very powerful. I think all of the other cliffhangers, they've been really, really powerful. But with this one, it sometimes felt a bit easy. It was okay, but I just really felt there was not a big enough energy into it. And although the Doctor does try and get the process machine back, but it doesn't really, and then suddenly the security chief takes away the Doctor and goes back into the time machine and dematerializes back to central control. And with that being said, it was such an easy operation to do. It was such an easy cliffhanger. And I was basically knew that the security was going to go there anyway and grab the doctor for re-interrogation. But the warlord was actually going to use the doctor for some use, or the war chief wanted a little chat with the doctor. And so, yeah, I would have to say that episode 7, brilliant introduction for the master in this entire scheme, the warlord. Fantastic villain. And I have to say, my favourite character out of the entire War Games. And I'm not too surprised that General Smile did get killed off in the end, because it didn't really feel like a big of a threat in my opinion. But really, I really thought that Philip Maddox acting for the Warlord, and it's just fantastic. And he is so calm, and he absolutely knows what to say in any situation. He's so confident, yet intimidating and sinister at the same time. And I really liked how he completely threatened the security chief and the war chief, both. And with those two bickering, the security chief and the war chief bickering with each other, the warlord is not getting his plan to where he wants it to be. And so really, they are trying to prevent the warlord from succeeding in his plan. And so he really came here and really wanted to stop them bickering and really focus on with the task in hand. So really, the warlord is a fantastic character. Now for part 8. Part 8, this is where the good guys really get their plan going. And I really like their montage when they're trying to break down and trying to disconnect all of the telecommunication devices within all the other time zones, and trying to collect more resistant members, and trying to deprocess all the processed humans to become unprocessed humans and resistance members, and therefore they could create a much bigger army so they could take over the central control zone. And what I really like about this is that the security chief is actually wasting a lot of his guards from the central control zone, and he's disputing all of the security guards around the entire of the war games in different time zones. And by doing that, he's leaving the entire central control unprotected. Like, no guards will be there at all, because they're all going to be situated in different time zones and probably again being destroyed. And so I really like how they're trying to eliminate so many guards, as well as trying to take possession of all of the time capsules as well, and so they could actually dematerialize and rematerialize back at central control and take control of the entire central control of the war games. So that was their plan all along, and I really liked them for them to do something finally. And I have to say, I really love the music. I think the music in all the different war zones are just absolutely spot on. And just the music of how when they're doing the montages and when they're doing their plan just creates a good feel that they're doing something productive. And another thing I like about this in the episode is that I can really understand all of the villains in this. All the villains in this story, they don't feel like carbon copies of each other. What I mean by it is that all the villains, they have different traits and different characteristics. They don't feel like the same villain all the time. Especially with the security chief, lots of animosity. And with the war chief, you've got he's very deceitful and and really contradicting towards the security chief, and really can twist words very, very well. And they've got the big badass himself, the warlord, who takes control of the entire situation and really hates incompetence so much. And so that's what I really like about all of the villains. They don't feel like carbon copies of each other. Especially with the side village, you've got General Smile, who seems about quite deceitful as well as a bit revengeful as well. But then you've got Von Wei, who's quite sinister and quite manipulative. And so all of the villains in this, they don't feel like carbon copies of each other. They don't feel like that they're automatically the same villain. And so that's what I really like about this story, because most of the time when they're trying to do so many villains in a story, they're trying to make all the villains the same personality. But with this story, they don't feel like they're the same character. They feel like they're all different, with all different characteristics and different traits. I really like that. I really like how this war chief and the doctor really have their discussion with just themselves, of where the war chief is talking with the doctor about how did he steal the TARDIS and why did he leave his planet. Because the war chief and the doctor, they're both from the same race, they're both Time Lords, but why did both of them leave their planets, and why did the doctor steal the TARDIS most importantly? And that really creates a lot of questions that will probably get answered maybe in the last episode, but it really just creates a lot of great question marks in my head, really. Or why did the Doctor leave a TARDIS, and why did he leave his planet? And I really liked their overall discussion as well. And also the Warlord and the War Chief persuading the Doctor to help them within their plan. But the Doctor helps them in their plan because he has no alternative. Otherwise, his friends will basically get blown up by a neutron bomb, which they're probably going to use. But what I really like about the Doctor in this is that he can become such a versatile character. Although he may be the very serious Doctor as we know at all, he won't go with the War Chief's plan or the Warlord's plan at all. But he can become such a versatile character, like he could change his character so well that he can actually betray Jamie and Zoe in the final cliffhanger, where he's actually, you know, ambushed the Resistance group into a trap. Which actually makes the villain so powerful and makes them feel like they're in the winning state. And with Patrick Troughton betraying on Jamie and Zoe, they feel like that the Doctor has given up on them and sort of betrayed them. But with the Resistance groups, they completely believe that the Doctor has turned up on them and they become really rebellious. But with the companions, Jamie and Zoe, they have doubt in their head that the Doctor might be betraying them for a reason. And so he probably have doubt in their head that the Doctor is actually, you know, betraying them because he has a reason for it. And so that's what I really like. But I do believe that that Patrick Troughton is such a versatile actor and he can change his personality so well that actually becoming so friends with Jamie and Zoe and the Resistance, then in the episode, in the cliffhanger, he could become a serious threat and actually put all of them in a trap and actually become a real enemy of them. So really, I really like episode 8 as the Doctor betrays his friends, really. And so it's a really great way of him extending him with his character and his overall performance as the Doctor. And he's so unpredictable. That's why I really like Patrick Troughton in this entire story. He's just so unpredictable, but very versatile as well. And so I really like the entire in this entire episode. I think the Warlord gets so much development within this episode. Although he's been introduced in episode 7, he does get more opportunities to prove himself and to develop his character more as becoming a very threatening figure. And how the War Chief is so incompetent with his job and arguing with the Security Chief again. Part 9, this is where the entire plotline of the War Games really ties up. Not necessarily concludes, but really ties up. As now everybody's been returning to their own times, and all the supporting characters leave the Doctor, Jamie and Zoe, and initially, the Time Lords are summoned by the Doctor, and Jamie and Zoe will probably think, oh yeah, the Time Lords are back, surely everybody's going to be fine. But no, really not for the Doctor and for the War Chief. The Warlord is still concluding with his plan on recommencing the War Games. Now he has the Doctor helping out within his plan. And when there was one point where the Doctor was actually offering to join up with the Warlord and his plan, the Warlord had laughed in such a sinister tone, which I absolutely loved. And just really created how intimidating and how threatening the Warlord is so to be. But then after the discussion about how these time capsules were a later model version of the TARDIS, and so the Doctor knew automatically on how the War Chief got the secret of time traveling and how he mastered the time capsules, but he didn't. And so the Doctor knew straight away what he was after in the first place, to become supreme ruler of the entire galaxy. The Doctor's TARDIS, of course. So he was after the Doctor's TARDIS because the time capsules only have a limited lifespan. The Security Chief finds out on the recordings that the War Chief and the Doctor had their discussion in episode 8. He found out that the War Chief was actually planning something against the War Games, against the Warlord's plan. And then for the Security Chief arrested the War Chief for his obligations and his contradicting deceitful personality of actually being so power hungry. The Security Chief actually now has some positive evidence against the War Chief to actually prove to the Warlord that he was actually trying to use the War Games as a way of getting power for himself as becoming the supreme ruler of the entire galaxy. I just really love that moment of where the Security Chief actually found something to point as evidence towards the War Chief. And then the Doctor persuaded the War Chief to help the Resistance group invade the entire war room and destroy the entire War Games. But the War Chief accidentally kills the Security Chief for revenge purposes, I know, because they both two were bickering at each other, and really, the War Chief really wanted some revenge against the Security Chief. But the Sidrads, the time capsules, there were only very few left and they only had little energy in them, which that became such difficulty for the Doctor, and it became such a difficult matter for the Doctor in order to bring everybody and return everybody to their own time zones. And so the Doctor really had to summon the Time Lords and take out the entire situation, because in many of the other stories that Patrotron's been featured in, like The Invasion, The Seeds of Death, The Power of the Daleks, The Evil of the Daleks, all these other different stories, he's actually found a way and actually coped on his own to deal with the problems and how to find a solution. But with this situation, he feels like that this situation is well too difficult for him to solve and find a solution. And so he summons the Time Lords, but by doing that, he actually suffers the consequences. He's actually going to be put on trial because he actually broke the laws of the Time Lords. And he's going to be put on trial, which might cause the consequences of his life and fate. So, and although all the characters do get returned to their normal time zones, I think the amount of characters in this entire story is just absolutely fantastic. The amount of characters, really, I would have to say my favourite supporting characters are is Carstairs, because he is such a faithful and loyal companion, almost like his third companion towards the Doctor, and really became another, a fourth member of the entire party with Zoe, Jamie and the Doctor, really became a very loyal and faithful friend of the Doctor, and I really give him his acting 10 out of 10 and his way of how he became such a loyal friend. Russell, I would have to say here, I like his bold characteristics of being a great leader. 10 out of 10 for him as well. The Mexican Bandit or Overvilla, I would have to say that I really wanted his character or his, you know, war zone to be entered into maybe episode 7 to give a little bit of backstory to the Mexican Bandits and their revolution and their history. But really, I would probably give him a 9 out of 10, only since he only appeared for 2 episodes. I hardly know his backstory and his character development, although he's very contradicting to any sort of situation, but he really gets really rebellious if somebody tries to betray us on him. Suddenly, like the Doctor, he gets really, really rebellious when he comes to the Doctor actually betraying on him. And especially the villains as well. I have to say, Von Wei, 10 out of 10 performances by David Garfield. General Smile, I would have to give him a 9 out of 10, because although he only appeared for 3 episodes, but I really liked his personality, but I think Von Wei is such a good side villain. And then we have the Security Chief, which I had to give 10 out of 10 for his lots of animosity within the story, bickering with the War Chief, and especially with the War Chief, 10 out of 10 for his performances, trying to twist words around and become quite contradict and very deceitful against the War Security Chief. And then at the end, the cliffhanger to the end that builds up so much suspense to the Time Lords. It's so haunting, but yet again builds tremendous suspense and really actually becomes such a real interesting but brilliant cliffhanger, just to tell the audience that the Time Lords are coming and they're coming for the Doctor, and it's going to be fatal for the Doctor. And it's just such a brilliant and haunting cliffhanger, building up so much suspense for the Time Lords to appear in episode 10. Just really fantastic suspense. And I really have to say that episode 9 really concluded the end for the War Games plotline and their plan. Because this is where the War Games completely finish, but it's not finished for the Warlord or the Doctor. Because the Warlord was the entire boss of this entire operation of the War Games. And of course the Doctor, the person who summoned the Time Lord, but unfortunately suffers the trial, and also his life depends on it as well, because as he broke the laws of leaving his planet and really now suffers the consequences of leaving his planet. And so unfortunately, the War Chief also does get killed off by the Warlord's guards as well, and so he doesn't manage to go to the Time Lord's planet, but he does get killed off in the end, and suddenly his dream of becoming supreme galactic ruler of the entire galaxy doesn't come true, unfortunately. So, episode 9, brilliant suspense to the War Games, but also for the Time Lords as well, and it really concludes the end for the War Games, as their plan is completely finished, everybody's been returned to their own times, and Carstairs leaving the Doctor, and the cliffhanger, really brilliant suspense. And I have to say that episode 9 is just so fantastic. Right, let's move on to the final part of the War Games, episode 10. Okay guys, we are at the final episode
of the War Games, episode 10. And I will have to say that episode 10 is my favourite episode out of the entire War Games. From start to finish, I have to say that episode 10 really just is so fantastic for many reasons. One, it is the introduction episode for the Time Lords. We really get to find out who they are. We also get to find out why did the Doctor steal a TARDIS and why did he leave his planet? And also the regeneration scene. So truly fantastic. It's brilliant effects. And the way that the Doctor does so well on defending himself in the trial is just so fantastic. Literally, when the Doctor and Zoe and Jamie are trying to escape, I really like the moment of where the Doctor has some time to explain on why did he leave his planet and why did he steal the TARDIS. And that really related to future references in the modern series. And that became such of a big story on how, why did he leave his planet and why did he steal the TARDIS? Only because he was bored and he really wanted to explore the entire galaxy and really save so many civilizations from danger. He was really so helpful in all of his, you know, power and his will to go out and save civilizations and explore new galaxies. That was his ultimate dream and his destiny, to explore the entire galaxy. So fantastic moment in that. Absolutely fantastic. And what I really like about this final episode, when the TARDIS is trying to materialize and trying to escape, the TARDIS actually lands in different locations of where the Doctor has been before. It actually lands on the sea, such as a little scene from Fury from the Deep. But also, there was also another scene of where the TARDIS is suspended in space, a scene from The Web of Fear. So the TARDIS is landing in different kind of episodes or stories of where the Doctor has been before. And then suddenly, the Doctor's trying to escape from the Time Lord's grasp of bringing the TARDIS back to his home planet. And unfortunately, the Doctor is brought back to his home planet and brought to see the Time Lords. And unfortunately, the Time Lords are not happy with the Doctor at all. The Doctor is there for his trial and he's unfortunately have to face his trial as he broke the laws of his planet and he will suffer the consequences. And the Warlord is also there as well. And I have to say that the Warlord does eventually, you know, dematerialize from the Time Lord's planet and does get imprisoned on his own planet and really just stays there for eternity and doesn't really leave at all. He's absolutely stuck there, trapped in a prison planet. And I have to say that Philip Maddock's acting on doing such a brilliant role as the Warlord, absolutely sensational acting, 10 out of 10 I have to give out. Just brilliant, brilliant acting. From episode 7 being quite the manipulative and quite threatening authoritative figure, to here where he's completely defenseless and doesn't really speak at all because he has nothing to say really and has nothing in his defense. And so really the Time Lords automatically force him to tell the truth under some mind control. And I have to say that the Time Lords, although they may be calm and quite in a representative manner, but they are quite brutal and very serious and quite determined to get the truth out of people. And they're really civilized people. And I really like the Time Lords and the music as well. It just creates so much suspense for the Time Lords and for a sudden scene that might come next. That I really like the scene of where the Doctor is defending himself in the trial. It is just so fantastic. Really, he is not only admitted that he has been interfering with the affairs in other planets and other civilizations, but he's also proud of them. While the Time Lords have been observing him throughout the entire galaxy, the Doctor has been fighting against the forces of evil. And even the Doctor managed to show the Time Lords a viewing figure of what the Doctor faced in his time in the TARDIS and what he did in the galaxy. He fought against the Quark, the Yetis, then you've got the Ice Warriors, the Cybermen, and then you've got the Deadly Daleks. And this was in his defense to defend himself against the Time Lords in his trial. And the Time Lord said, like, is that all you have to say? Well, isn't it enough? And so, basically, Patrick Troughton, again, very funny and very comedic, but also very serious, because he's actually defending against for his life, because you never know what the consequences might be for the Doctor. And so, I had to give out sensational acting from Patrick Troughton, 10 out of 10 performances from Patrick Troughton. And one of the most heartbreaking scenes I have to say is the departure of Jamie and Zoe leaving the Doctor. It's just so heartbreaking just to see Jamie and Zoe leaving the Doctor. This is like one of the most emotional scenes in classic Who history. This is where
first time in Classic Who, the audience gets very emotional because Jamie has been with the Doctor all the time ever since that the Doctor has started in Power of the Daleks. His second story was the Highlanders, and this is where his bond with Jamie really brought up in every single episode and every single story that the Doctor has been with Jamie. Jamie has been with the Doctor throughout his career, and it's just such an emotional and heartbreaking scene just to see them both separate and say their goodbyes. It was just so emotional, and this is where Classic Who really gets so emotional, and it's just so heartbreaking just to see the companion say goodbye to the Doctor. And also another thing that I don't like, what happens to Jamie and Zoe, they forget their adventures with the Doctor, and unfortunately that's what the Time Lords do. They erase their memories of having so many great adventures with the Doctor. They only remember their first encounter with the Doctor, and that's it. And so I don't really like that, of companions forgetting their adventures with the Doctor. I don't think that's really wise to do, but oh well, it's happened then. But I have to say that the emotional scene between Jamie leaving the Doctor and Zoe as well, it's just brilliant. And I have to give out 10 out of 10 performances from Zoe and Jamie throughout Zoe's performances in all Doctor Who stories, as well as with Jamie and all the other companions in Doctor Who history, with Patrick Troughton, Ben and Polly, Jamie, Victoria and Zoe. 10 out of 10 performances from both of them all the way through. And I have to say that in this entire story and throughout his entire life, Patrick Troughton, sensational performances in every single story that he has done, and especially in the War Games, his finale story and the final scene of where he regenerates, of where, and then he's now exiled to Earth, and he will remain there for as long as the Time Lord plead. And this is almost like torture for a Time Lord. Not necessarily, but for the Doctor, that seems like torture. Exiled to Earth, stuck in one time in one place, and he can't really time travel at all, and so he's completely stuck there on Earth for the rest of his life until the Time Lords free him. It's a really torturous and very punishment for the Doctor. And also, again, the Doctor has to force to change his appearance, and it was so funny just to see him all, you know, insulting all of the other choices that he could have had to be regenerating into, like, oh, he's too old, oh, he's too fat, isn't he? No, he's too thin, I was too young, I don't do it at all, it's ridiculous. It was so funny just to watch that, so comedic and so very serious and so cautious as well of his appearance. But I have to say that he was very serious all throughout the entire War Games. Absolutely fantastic acting from Patrick Troughton. Really, I have to say that also the regeneration scene in the end, really fantastic effects. And I have to say, to an end to a brilliant Doctor, Patrick Troughton, 10 out of 10 performances in the War Games. And I have to say that really concludes the end of the War Games review. And I have to say, this has been one of the biggest reviews that I've ever done on my YouTube channel and for my Doctor Who marathon. And I really have to say, I hope you have enjoyed it. Please do give a like, but also comment your views on this story if you have seen it. And also please, please do subscribe to my channel if you are new, because I've taken so much time on doing this review for so long, and I hope you have enjoyed it. I really have to say that Patrick Troughton and Jon Pertwee as well, since the next Doctor is Jon Pertwee, both of them really made Doctor Who what it was, and they completely continued its legacy into the 1970s in colour version. And this is where Doctor Who really had a decision to make. Was it going to get cancelled, the end of an era, or was Jon Pertwee going to bring it back and really become a sensational show in the 1970s? And it did. And it lived on for many years to come. And so we have to thank Patrick Troughton for his amazing acting. And I have to say that the War Games, such a fantastic, sensational, phenomenal story to end a fantastic Doctor. Really, one of the best old-time brilliant stories in Doctor Who history. You probably know what the overall rating is. It is absolutely 4 marks, 10 out of 10. And I highly, highly recommend you pick this up and you watch it, all of it. Because believe me or not, I have actually given you a lot of spoilers to look out for in the War Games. But that's how I do my reviews. I really want to give you guys, all my opinions on the War Games. And I have to say, I have really enjoyed doing this review for all of you guys. The War Games review, such a sensational story, and the acting, the main cast, the characters, the scenes, the plot lines, all of the characters, especially the villains, they get so much development. And with Carstairs, all the supporting characters, and all of the fight scenes, the direction, the writing, everything with the War Games is truly, truly done to perfection. An absolute legendary story in Doctor Who history. This actually may even be my number one best story in all of Doctor Who history. But there's one story in particular that kind of beats this story. I'm not going to tell you what it is. You're going to have to find out in hopefully many other Doctor Who reviews. But there is actually another story that actually beats the War Games. And I have to say, you would have to stay tuned for more to find out what is that number one spot of my all-time favourite classic stories of all time. But this is certainly at number two. Because you can certainly say what a legendary story this is, and how Patrick Troughton is such a sensational, versatile, and most brilliant actor. So fantastic. And this is just the perfect send-off to a brilliant, brilliant Doctor. And this really ends the 1960s decade with an absolute bang. Sensational for story. Really fantastic. 10 out of 10 for me. It is such a fantastic war story, really. And so, guys, thank you for watching for this review on the War Games. I hope you have enjoyed it. Again, please do give a like, share your support by commenting down below on your opinions of the War Games. And also, please, please do subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. I have spent so much time working on this entire review. Absolutely, I've been working so hard to make sure that I get this review so out. But from now on, I will be doing more reviews often, because this has been the most biggest and most longest Doctor Who review that I have ever done on my Doctor Who marathon and on my YouTube channel, which may be possible. But the next video will be my top 10 1960s stories to conclude the 1960s era for Doctor Who. And then after that, we will move on to the 1970s decade, and starting off with John Pertwee's era all the way to Tom Baker's era to conclude the 1970s. But guys, thank you for watching so much, and I'm glad you have survived this entire massive review of the War Games. And I have to say, pick up this DVD, because you are missing out big time on such a sensational, fantastic story. 10 out of 10 ratings for me. Absolutely. I can continue talking like this all day, saying so many great things about the War Games. I just have to say, thank you guys for watching for my entire in-depth review on the War Games. Thank you guys for watching, and I will see you guys very soon. Enjoy the rest of your day. Peace out.